Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The China Dream, How the Aspirations of Government, Business, and People are Driving the Greatest Transformation in History, by Jonathan A. Krane. Narrated by Rick Adamson. Publisher's Note: This audiobook contains references to visuals present in the print and ebook editions of the book. Introduction. Building Bridges. Growing up in Boston, I was fascinated by a place called China, which always seemed so far away. I made it to mainland China as a business student in 1998, and what I saw absolutely amazed me. China in 1998 was worlds away from where it is today. Back then, many people traveled by bike and moped. Electricity was not available everywhere. Cities were a crowded mass of old, congested streets, temples, shanty towns, and factories. Through all of that, I saw potential. Everyone I interacted with was industrious and ambitious. Despite incredible struggles, including but certainly not limited to the Cultural Revolution, the one-child policy, and low incomes in most of the country, I nonetheless sensed a great deal of optimism among China's people, at least those whom I was fortunate enough to meet. I saw an incredible, untapped entrepreneurial spirit. After that trip, I would not return until 2003. I was eager to see what opportunities I could find. As a young entrepreneur, I figured that market research into China would be complicated, but that the potential was unmatched. Size, capital, and drive were the three key words that always came up whenever I was discussing the opportunities in China with potential investors and partners. I saw 1.3 billion people, a massive consumer market, and most importantly, an intense drive to catch up with the developed world. Today, we talk of China's tremendous high-tech output and contributions to aspirational technologies such as artificial intelligence. But when I first arrived, those segments of the economy were virtually non-existent. China had not yet developed the infrastructure or intellectual capital necessary to make advances in those sectors. At the time, most, if not all, of the country's economic and political weight was put behind manufacturing for export. Nonetheless, I could sense dynamic opportunities afoot. Despite the naysayers, especially those who warned me not to uproot my life and move to China when the country was in the middle of a viral epidemic, SARS, I was determined to move forward on China opportunities. When I arrived in Beijing, I was truly starting at zero. Other than a few people that I had met on my previous trip, I had no leads on business opportunities, much less potential corporate and government relationships. By some stroke of chance, I found myself sitting in the office of Poly Group, a state-owned megafirm responsible for, among other things, directing funding for entertainment and culture throughout the country. Poly Group was a behemoth of a company. The group of companies was involved in so many different businesses that I could hardly tell which was the focus of management. Though, if I had to guess, it was defense manufacturing. Poly Group handled the manufacturing of most of the equipment used by China's military, and still does a great deal of that today. A particularly intimidating sector, I know. But I was not deterred by that in the slightest. Fortunately, the group was expanding to include soft businesses, like arts and entertainment, and I decided I wanted to be a part of that initiative. Poly Group was eventually quite successful at expanding into industries other than defense manufacturing. Today, they are a major player in the fine art business in China and Asia, operating a great deal of auctions in the Asian art market. Today, if you go to Poly's Beijing headquarters, you can buy a painting on one floor and a missile system on another. While working with state-owned enterprises, or SOEs, might seem taboo to the typical American business person, These firms actually work synergistically with entrepreneurs. SOEs generally want to do business in a conservative manner and minimize risk. Paradoxically, this characteristic makes them the perfect match for a bold entrepreneur. I offered to take a lot of the upfront risk and, in turn, receive a bigger share of the revenue. I saw an opportunity in the entertainment and media space. Though I could have found opportunity anywhere during this period of dramatic change, not only in the way China operated internally, but also the way China dealt with the rest of the world. Over the 6 years leading up to the 2008 Olympics, the government decided that it needed to open up the country to live international content, sort of a massive rehearsal before the Games. Everything was needed to pull this off, from infrastructure, such as concert halls, to domestic marketing capacity, to access to networks of foreign talent. State-owned enterprises like Poly Group would be called on to lead the charge, but they would also need foreign companies and entrepreneurs to help. Artists such as Beyoncé and the Rolling Stones already had millions of fans in China, but few fans had ever seen these performers live. David Copperfield, the Las Vegas magician, was one of the only major international acts Chinese fans had seen within the country at that time. There was clearly an intense need for more entertainment events with performers from abroad. In 2004, I founded Emma Entertainment, an international entertainment promotions and ticketing company. After countless trips, meetings, fundraising activities, odd tasks, and grunt work, way too numerous to recount here, we had our first concert in Beijing featuring Whitney Houston in July 2004. It was a symbolic and surreal occurrence to have Whitney Houston come to China for the first time. The look on the faces of 25,000 people who attended the concert in Beijing gave me the impression that my team and I had helped make their dreams come true. I saw people crying at our first concert and was incredibly moved. That experience inspired me to keep moving along with this grand vision. Eventually, we hosted numerous other acts with the Rolling Stones, Beyoncé, Eric Clapton, Celine Dion, Linkin Park, and the Backstreet Boys among our most popular headliners. We were given 2 months to get a ticketing service up and running, so we enlisted the services of a private label ticket site from Singapore, which helped us reach customers across China in the most efficient way possible. We were the first to bring barcode ticketing to China. Using barcodes prevents counterfeiting and cleans up the marketplace. The modest efficiency gain from the use of barcodes was only the first of many to come and at a fever pitch. At the time we launched Emma Entertainment in 2004, people primarily used cash to purchase physical tickets. People used cash for everything back then. It was just how the economy was run. Then we started using debit cards, and from there we went straight to mobile payments. It happened quickly, in a matter of just a few years. I could not believe the speed of technology adoption. I witnessed firsthand how this rapid transition rate completely surpassed technology adoption speeds in the United States. Any success in business or in life grows out of struggle. While the market opportunity was promising, the challenges were real. First, the all-important task of team building was incredibly difficult. Getting a knowledgeable team on the ground in China was one thing, but getting a team of people we could trust was even more difficult. At first, I had to place blind faith in people I had just met. Eventually, Poly Group was able to connect me with the right people. On the flip side, I had to get people to trust me when I had only just started my business and did not speak the local language. This was another place where Poly Group came through for me in a major way. They gave me credibility. So when anyone found out that I was partnered with Poly, they were immediately open to doing business because they knew we were legitimate, or at the very least, they knew there was a state-owned behemoth behind the operation. Poly was a substantial partner. We also began to establish partnerships with other government entities and companies in Beijing and Shanghai and across cities in China. In doing so, I had to gain the trust of and work closely with key partners in various provinces and cities. Each area, in turn, had its own local business climate, culture, and social dynamics. As such, I took what I would describe as a portfolio approach to partnerships. While it is probably always smart to diversify and have multiple partners, this is especially true when doing business in China. It is truly a mistake to take China as a monolith. The amount of diversity within the country is astonishing and always reminds me of the diversity of the United States. Contrary to what you may hear, there is a great deal of political diversity in China. While the central government is powerful, one cannot get by doing business across China without gaining the support of local centers of power as well. I found out quickly that I had to be the trusted bridge for this whole project to work. Many international music and media companies were eager to get into China's massive market. This was especially true for live performances. At the time, the music industry was just beginning to realize that the bulk of their revenues would increasingly be sourced from selling live performances. The huge China market was incredibly tempting. The main problem they faced was getting artists and financial backers on board due to lack of trust. In the early 2000s, there was even less information and legal reciprocity between China and the U.S. and other developed markets than there is today. Agents, clients, and their backers were hesitant to book shows in China for fear that the quality of the production and experience for audiences and artists would not be on par with developed markets, and they worried they would not be paid. Fortunately, my partnership with Poly Group helped me smooth over these issues. Seeing that Poly Group was backed by the government and had a substantial balance sheet, agents finally had the confidence to book concerts in China through Emma Entertainment. Their entry through us was also facilitated by my team and me. And because agents had no existing connections within the market, we were granted exclusive rights to handle promotion and ticketing for these events. I began traveling to China regularly in 2002 and sold my first business there within 5 years. I found success in a very short period of time, albeit with a tremendous amount of work and brute effort. I attribute this quick turnaround to the ease of doing business in China even then. Granted, I was able to find trusted China partners early on, but to reiterate, I started with nothing. I lived in China for a total of 5 years. After I had completed the sale of Emma Entertainment to Ticketmaster, I stayed on through the Beijing Olympics, where I was invited to be part of the torch-carrying ceremony. In 2008, I reached a significant milestone in my life. My wife and I had our first child, who was born in Shanghai. Shortly after my daughter was born, we decided to move back to New York. But when I arrived in New York in 2009, China was still on my mind. Now living in New York City, the financial capital of the world, my interest in China transformed. I became interested in the money flows between the U.S. and China. China was diversifying investment globally for the first time. China was also one of the U.S.'s largest trading partners, and numerous American firms had invested heavily in fixed assets in China. They manufactured goods at a low cost and eventually sold those goods in the U.S. This led to a great capital influx into China and contributed to the growth of the domestic economy. I wanted to develop a way for anyone to invest in the growth of the China economy. My friends in the financial services industry told me that, at the time, ETFs were a growing trend and product type in asset management. I also decided that ETFs, exchange-traded funds, which create baskets of securities into listed products in specific sectors, such as China internet companies, in addition to being a megatrend, could be an excellent tool to allow anyone to invest in China. Therefore, I wanted to pursue starting a company focused on two megatrends, ETFs and China. In 2013, I founded KraneShares, and we launched our first ETF, the KraneShares CSI Overseas China Internet ETF, which is more commonly referred to by its ticker, KWEB. The ETF provides exposure to a basket of innovative internet-based companies with an eye to the burgeoning tech scene in China and China's rapidly increasing internet penetration rate. Of course, the ETF has always included the storied e-commerce giants Alibaba and Tencent. In fact, we have held Alibaba's shares pretty much since its IPO, initial public offering. Through my experience, I knew that there were many other tech companies in China that were disrupting industries in myriad ways, Alibaba Plus, if you will. That is why our fund includes many companies beyond Alibaba and Tencent and can automatically allocate to new players as they go public and their businesses expand. The next megatrend that inspired me and my team at KraneShares was the inclusion of Chinese stocks in MSCI's world-leading indexes. MSCI is a global leader in financial indexing, meaning that trillions of dollars of managed capital are invested based off their indexes. We anticipated that MSCI would eventually begin to track Chinese stocks listed in the mainland on the Shanghai and Shenzhen stock exchanges and include these stocks in the MSCI global indexes. So, when they did, we were prepared with an ETF based on their index for China mainland equities and this inclusion story. Over the years, we continued to launch new products, capturing different investment themes within China's market, including healthcare, consumer products, clean technology, and the Belt and Road Initiative, China's massive overseas infrastructure plan. Even though U.S. and multinational corporations had been investing in China for years, China was a relatively new allocation target for asset managers and asset allocators. For this reason, we saw ourselves as, more than anything else, filling the knowledge void for U.S. and global investors about China. After all, we were the only asset management firm to focus exclusively on China. While we have now expanded our product suite to include investments outside China, mainly other emerging markets, China investing remains our specialty and continues to set us apart from the competition. Evidently, that knowledge gap needed to be filled. Our business has grown tremendously since 2013. We now have over $15 billion in assets under management, AUM. Over the years, I have called on industry veterans from the likes of J.P. Morgan, Goldman Sachs, BlackRock, and Oppenheimer to join our team and help build a truly amazing business. Applying a portfolio approach to partners, which I had learned in China, I also had people from a variety of disciplines come and join us, including web developers and marketing professionals. Such success would not have been possible without our incredible team. In 2017, we were fortunate enough to be acquired by China International Capital Corporation, CICC, one of China's leading investment banks, which was founded in 1995 by Morgan Stanley and China Construction Bank, CCB, representing the Chinese government. CICC had the foresight early to begin providing investment banking services within mainland China, and today CICC is a full-service investment bank and a leader in IPO, M&A, advisory, private equity, wealth management, trading, research, and asset management. CICC has, in turn, provided us with invaluable support and has been an excellent partner. CICC's largest shareholder is China Investment Corporation, CIC, the $1 trillion China Sovereign Wealth Fund. China's amazing growth looks likely to continue virtually unabated after the COVID-19 pandemic of 2020. For one thing, the Chinese healthcare system is being completely modernized and revamped. For another, internet and e-commerce have flourished and grown during the crisis. We will examine this more closely in Chapter 10. At my firm, we are committed to fostering mutual understanding between the United States and China. We think that China cannot, and more perhaps more importantly, should not, grow in isolation, and that this growth benefits the entire world, especially the U.S. In our work and in this book, we hope to provide a balanced perspective on China's growth while providing global investors with the necessary tools to capture this growth in their portfolios. Our core beliefs: more and more Chinese companies in increasingly diverse sectors of the economy are growing because their revenues are growing. These firms continue to be undervalued by the markets. The opening of China's capital markets represents a tremendous opportunity for investors all over the world. China has become its own asset class, and as such, an exposure to China is an important component of a well-balanced portfolio. We believe global institutional flows will significantly increase into China's equity and fixed income markets over the next 5 to 10 years. We believe the political and economic relationship between the U.S. and China is the most important relationship of the 21st century. We believe that as China's prominence on the world stage expands, U.S. investors will need to increase their understanding and education regarding China. We believe China will successfully make the transition to a developed economy and eventually become the world's largest. Despite the competitive tension between the world's two largest economies, we believe China and the United States can coexist in a positive and mutually beneficial manner. However, the road to prosperity and understanding will require commitments from both countries to understand each other better, including culture, goals, and visions for their respective citizens. After all, no meaningful dream is ever brought to life without hard work. Despite the immense opportunity, China faces a multitude of challenges. These include the demographics of an aging population and a highly educated young population going into service businesses, over-leveraging, especially in the real estate sector, which is also a consequence of having established the best transportation infrastructure the world has ever seen, legal frameworks that are transitioning to a global platform, a changing role for foreign companies, and the need for further economic opening. Our aim is to understand China, not to change China. As one of the world's oldest civilizations, change is likely only to come from within. The great empires of Europe long tried to have a lasting influence on and exert control over China, but failed at nearly every attempt. Understanding China requires foregoing many assumptions we commonly use to analyze Western societies. Nonetheless, I believe that China has much to learn from our system and that we can learn from theirs as well. While I could go on, I will leave political debates to those more qualified to comment on them. What I want to do now is show you how the Chinese economy works on the ground, its challenges, its advantages, and why I think it is the most exciting place on earth to do business right now. To be honest, I am more excited now about the possibilities in China than I was when I introduced the country to Eric Clapton and the Rolling Stones. I'm going to talk about dozens of Chinese companies, some of which you might not have heard of. While my company's funds own the shares of many of these, my mentioning them is in no way an endorsement, nor is my list anywhere near exhaustive. Think of it as an invitation to find out more about anything that catches your eye. Another purpose is to surface a basic truth that is often lost in the daily back and forth over trade or currency or foreign policy. On the world stage, China isn't going anywhere, and we all need to understand more. If my China ventures have taught me anything, it is the power of fostering reciprocal trust as well as building bridges where none existed previously. China's consumers and leaders wanted live international entertainment, and global talent was ready to go to China. But they needed a bridge. They needed someone to take that first risky step and connect the two. The theme of building bridges continues to characterize everything I do, especially at Krane Shares. With that in mind, I hope you enjoy my insights on China, why partnerships with China are important as we head toward mid-century, and how to build bridges between the world's two largest economies. Chapter 1. The China Dream. When then-Secretary of State Henry Kissinger and President Richard Nixon made their fabled approach to China, Chinese trade with the U.S. was less than U.S. trade with Honduras. Mao Zedong's Cultural Revolution was still fresh, and the market reforms of Deng Xiaoping were just ripening. The controlled capitalism of leaders ranging up to Xi Jinping has resulted in an explosion of per capita GDP, gross domestic product, since 1978, and a dramatic drop in poverty. In 1971, when Nixon asked Kissinger to reach out to China, the U.S. had no relationship at all with China. "We didn't know any of the Chinese leaders. We didn't know which door to knock on," Kissinger said. China was one of the poorest, most isolated countries in the world, with very little trade and very little interaction with the Western world. Today, China is the second largest economy in the world and deeply integrated into the world economy. A lot has changed since Kissinger's initial visit. By comparison to the U.S.'s relationship with China, Kissinger said that in the early 20th century, no one would have predicted that Germany and England would go to war. Like China and the U.S., Germany and England had no major conflicts. They shared many common values and interests, and Kaiser Wilhelm and the British royal family were even related by birth. By 1914, however, Germany and England began fighting a war that neither side wanted and neither side would have predicted. Each country also never fully recovered the relative power they enjoyed prior to the war. In the 20th century, the American dream became a reality, based on ever-improving quality of life paired with unmatched global influence. Americans moved from the farm to the city, welcomed immigrants seeking a better life, invented and spread the latest technologies, automobiles, telephones, radio, television, built world-class infrastructure, the Hoover Dam, the Interstate Highway System, helped end two devastating world wars, spread their culture all around the world, and created a standard of living never before seen. China has grown significantly in the 21st century, yet still has incredible potential. If you walk down any street in Beijing, Shanghai, or a dozen other huge Chinese cities, you see everybody staring at their smartphones, just as people do in New York or Los Angeles. However, only slightly more than half the Chinese population owns one. That's a potential additional market of 700 million. And as new Chinese cities much larger than New York City spring up every year, there's a massive new market for building houses, office buildings, restaurants, highways, bridges, self-driving cars, hospitals, rail lines, high-speed trains, and, well, you get the idea. The Chinese have a dream too, and in their context, it might be even more ambitious. As President Xi Jinping expressed it in a speech in Seattle in 2014, His dream as a village official in the 1960s was to enable everybody to eat meat, then in short supply. This goal served as a metaphor for living a better life. Toward the end of the 1960s, when I was in my teens, I was sent from Beijing to work as a peasant in a small village where I spent 7 years. At that time, the villagers and I lived in earth caves and slept on earth beds. Life was very hard. There was no meat in our diet for months. I knew what the villagers wanted the most. Later, I became the village's party secretary and began to lead the villagers in production. One thing I wished most at the time was to make it possible for the villagers to eat meat to their heart's content. But it was very difficult for such a wish to come true in those years. At the spring festival earlier this year, I returned to the village. It was a different place now. I saw blacktop roads. Now living in houses with bricks and tiles, the villagers had internet access. Elderly folks had basic old age care, and all villagers had medical care coverage. Children were in school. Of course, meat was readily available. This made me keenly aware that the Chinese dream is, after all, a dream of the people. We can fulfill the Chinese dream only when we link it with our people's yearning for a better life. What has happened in my village is but a microcosm of the progress China has made through reform and opening up. In a little more than 3 decades, we have turned China into the world's second largest economy, lifted 1.3 billion people from a life of chronic shortage, and brought them initial prosperity and unprecedented rights and dignity. For me, President Xi's speech encapsulates the original spirit of the China dream and documents the transformation that occurred during his lifetime. Now, more than 50 years later, most Chinese can eat as much meat as they want. The country consumes 1/4 of the world's meat. However, that dream has morphed into much more, and now aspires to make China a leader in technological innovation and to share their development model with the rest of the world. His dream envisions moving millions more people from farms into burgeoning cities, linking them all together by high-speed trains and highways designed to eventually accommodate self-driving cars, bringing electricity and fifth-generation phone service, 5G, to everyone, and creating the most efficient financial ecosystem possible, virtually eliminating cash and credit card transactions in the process. As with the American dream realized in the 20th century, a corollary of Xi's dream is to build roads, railways, bridges, canals, and ports from Singapore to Stockholm, Assam to Azerbaijan, all connected by the most modern communications networks supplied by Chinese companies. Known as the Belt and Road Initiative, this effort has the potential to revolutionize transport and shipping in many regions of the world that fell outside America's purview following World War II, such as Central Asia and East Africa. And yes, this will cause the spread of China's language and culture, just as similar efforts by the U.S. spurred the spread of American culture. Put another way, the China dream is to become the most vibrant, innovative, and engaged economy that it can be, both for its own people and the rest of the world. The 21st century is shaping up to be the Chinese century, just as the 20th was the American century. China's dream is on a similar path as the American dream. It has the same dynamics: urbanization, industrialization, and innovation. The American dream was accessible to everyone and spread hope across the country and the world. We are seeing this same hope in China. Already, China is creating more millionaires and billionaires than anywhere else on Earth, and for many of the reasons detailed in the rest of this book. You could look at it as the greatest wealth creation exercise in history, but that would just be scraping the glittery surface. The Chinese dream goes far deeper. To me, no one more embodies the China dream, nor the idea of building bridges, than Derek Yan, one of our star investment analysts who joined KraneShares in 2015. There are millions of people with similar backgrounds in China, and understanding their stories is key to understanding the China dream. No country in the world has a generational gap as wide as China's. For my family, life today is worlds away from life 60 years ago. As a lucky child, I grew up in a reformed and open China. Admittedly, I took a lot for granted and assumed that China had always been the way it is today, Derek shared with me. However, stories from my grandpa and my father completely reshaped my views. How could a country change so much from generation to generation? After hearing those stories, I felt a deeper connection to my family history and knew that my family had witnessed one of the most significant developments in human history. My grandpa was born before the Communist Party won the Civil War and founded the People's Republic of China in 1949. My grandpa's family was running a traditional Chinese medicine business in a small city in Yangxi. Most of the people were using traditional Chinese medicine and herbs back then. The company was pretty profitable, though my great-grandfather wanted to settle down and raise a family. So he bought land and properties in a rural village nearby. By collecting rents, the family was able to afford a pretty decent life. However, when the New China was founded in 1949, new policies came to the quiet village. Everyone had to give up ownership of their lands and allow for those lands to be evenly distributed among the population. As a prominent landowner, my grandpa's family tried to fight against giving up their land, but their efforts landed them in prison. Eventually, the family gave up all the land, but fortunately was able to hang on to a big house to live in. My grandpa was already a teenager then. Everyone had to join the socialist working group and earn working credits, which could be exchanged for food and living necessities. Since my grandpa and his brother were young and hardworking, they were able to make enough credits for the family. He said life was still not bad until the year 1958, the year in which my father was born. Everyone was happy about the newborn, but then news came that every farmer would set up a backyard furnace, a makeshift furnace for smelting industrial metals to be used in the Great Leap Forward industrialization push. Many lands were thus abandoned as a result, which meant that there eventually was not enough food for everyone. The family was starving along with the young child, my father. They had to work extremely hard just to scrape by and feed themselves. Things were finally getting better several years later, when everyone was told to go back to the field and grow crops. My grandpa therefore believed that life could be better in the future. However, 1966 saw the beginning of the Cultural Revolution. Unfortunately, my father and his family had been classified as rich farmers when the PRC was founded. They never thought much of the title. But when society was thrown into chaos by the Cultural Revolution, it became a derogatory term. The whole family was kicked out of their home and forced to live in a small cowshed. My great-grandpa had to wear a tall hat and kneel down in humiliation. People would gather and criticize him for his evil wealth in the past. My uncle was a little kid then, and at one point he became sick. My grandpa was permitted to bring him to the doctor, but was unable to afford the cost of health care, equivalent to 20 cents. He asked many neighbors to help, but no one dared help a rich farmer family. People were afraid that a close relationship with a rich farmer family could result in the same social ostracism. My uncle passed away from illness, as he was never able to receive care. Local officials then forced my grandpa to work longer hours. The working group leader told him to cultivate the land during the freezing winter in his bare feet. Life had become as though they were in prison, since the whole family was under constant surveillance. Neighbor kids would bully my father because he is from a rich farmer family. Even though he was a good student, his application to high school was denied by the local government officials because they discovered my father had been reading a novel that had been deemed politically dangerous. Everyone seemed to lose hope. When Teng Xiaoping announced a plan to reform and open up the country in 1979, the government permitted my family to return to their original house. In 1980, lands were quasi-privatized, everyone was better incentivized, and production levels rose. In 1984, my father turned 26 and had been growing crops for several years now. He kept hearing of all kinds of new opportunities arising from people returning to the village. Despite only receiving a primary school education, those politically wrong novels inspired him. He wanted to make a lot of money and become a significant figure. That was his China dream. He used his savings to move out to a little town nearby. He bought a three-wheel truck using all the money he had left and started a logistics business. By delivering wood, coal, and even passengers, he survived in the town. For 3 years, he worked 14 hours a day, 7 days a week. He barely spent any money, though he felt very enriched. Through extreme saving, together with a friend, he was able to buy a small cargo ship. The coal and wood shipping business was booming in China at the time, as the country was just beginning to build modern infrastructure. Factories needed coal for steel, and builders needed wood to build factories and homes. He saw tremendous opportunities in logistics in the city, so he sold his share of the cargo ship and bought a big truck. When he moved to the city, he heard that the government was building a railroad across the city and would be in need of timber. He participated in the bidding process and won the contract for 1,000 square meters of timber in 10 days at a reasonable price. The competitor declared the contract mission impossible for my father. In one round trip, he could only deliver 10 plus square meters. Therefore, it would require 100 trips in 10 days. My father started to drive like crazy while getting only the minimum amount of sleep he needed. Even the timber suppliers were touched by his efforts, and many of them volunteered to help him load his truck. He finally made it just before the deadline. The manager of the railroad project was impressed by his efforts and awarded him with many contracts over the years. He then expanded the team using the earnings from those contracts and finally built some wealth. Later on, he started out in the real estate business as well and moved to the city where he met my mother and got married. He achieved his China dream after starting out as a poor farmer from a small village. In 1991, I was born in that city. Unlike my father and grandfather, I was fortunate enough to lead a decent life in the city and receive a proper education from K through 12. Competition is fierce for college admittance in China. Although I was more interested in basketball and PC games when I was young, peer pressure always pulled me back to the books. My grandparents moved to the city and lived with me when I entered middle school. They never received much education, but they somehow still knew the value of education and encouraged me to study hard. Emphasizing education has been a tradition in China for thousands of years. You need to study hard, and it will make a big difference. I was even more hardworking in school because I wanted to make my parents and grandparents proud. Study time was never limited by the boundaries of the school day. In high school, it lasted from 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. and was intense the entire time. Luckily, I did well on the college entrance exam and attended a good college in China. Throughout my childhood, the city changed dramatically. My father's real estate business was growing very well since more and more people had begun moving to the city in search of a better life. There are 1.4 billion people in China, and around 900 million are farmers. Just like my father, moving to the city offers so many an opportunity to change their lives forever. As more people moved to the city, new business opportunities were created. I remember that many of my neighbors got rich from starting and working at all kinds of new businesses, from providing materials to a new fire station, to running an internet cafe, to running restaurants and hotels. Everyone was also constantly upgrading their houses. My parents' first apartment in the city was around 300 square feet. They moved into a 1,200 plus square foot apartment when I was in middle school and a three-floor villa when I was in high school. After attending college in Beijing, I hunted for a job in the city. I felt that there should be more opportunities in Beijing. Many of my friends had made a similar choice. They tended to settle in Beijing, Shanghai, Shenzhen, or other big cities in China. I joined the financial industry due to the potential for high pay. Most students from my college preferred to join the financial, consulting, internet, or other high-paying industries in the big city. Almost everyone received a K-12 education in China, so college is a key differentiator when applying for those jobs. China joined the WTO in 2002, at which point most people began to believe that they would have more opportunities if they attended a U.S. college, which was now a remote possibility. The K-12 education in China also offers English education, which makes it easier for people to keep studying English and apply for higher education abroad in English-speaking countries. After working in the financial industry for a year in Beijing, I had a similar ambition. I wanted to work in the most advanced financial industry in the world. I got an offer from a business school in Massachusetts, quit my job, and flew to the U.S. all on my own. In the beginning, it was a very lonely life in the U.S., but it was also exciting because everything was completely new to me. I remember my first landlord's thick Boston accent fondly. Eventually, I found that Americans are similar to Chinese people in one important way. Everyone wants to work hard and believes that they create a better life for themselves through hard work. The entrepreneurial spirit that I learned from my classmates inspired me. When I graduated, I joined a company with an entrepreneurial spirit that focuses on investing in China, KraneShares. Since I was born and raised in China and had seen all the miracles that happened in China, I sincerely believe that many more great companies will be built in China. The growth of China may just be the greatest opportunity for every investor in the world. I found that this would be an excellent career for me, helping global.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.